AWS Online Lecture 2021. Today's topic is about hemostasis. What is hemostasis? Basically, it is the most important topic of the blood module. So today we are discussing it. So let's go to the first slide. What are the objectives of today's lecture? That is number one, mechanism of coagulation. How a coagulation occurs. Normal hemostasis. What is the definition, mechanism, steps involving in hemostasis? What are the tests? Abnormal thrombosis, abnormal bleeding. These abnormal thrombosis and abnormal bleeding would be the topic of our next lecture. So we are just only discussing overview and the mechanism of normal hemostasis. Okay, hemostasis. Hemostasis is a process that keeps blood in a fluid state and in circulation. It prevents blood loss. That is the main statement of this definition. It prevents blood loss. Basically, hemostasis is a process which prevents blood loss from a damaged vessel by formation of a clot or a platelet plug. So, four interconnected mechanisms form the basis of hemostasis. What are the four mechanisms? First of all, blood vessel contraction, platelet plug formation, that is the primary hemostasis, while clot stabilization with fibrin cross-linking, that is the clot formation, that is the secondary hemostasis, and endogenous fibrinolysis, that is the after the formation of a clot, that clot need to be fibrinolyzed, means to be removed so that normal circulation persists. So there are four steps and mechanisms of hemostasis. Number one, blood vessel contraction or constriction, platelet plug formation, that is primary hemostasis, clot stabilization, clot formation, or endogenous fibrinolysis. We will discuss each and every individual mechanism in detail. What is involved in hemostasis? These are blood vessels, obviously, where the trauma occurs, where blood vessel injury occurs, platelets, plasma coagulation factors. These are the basically protein produced in the liver that forms, that are main in the formation of a clot in blood damaged vessel. Inhibitors. These are also the proteins that prevent abnormal formation of a clot in running circulation in small vessel. Fibrinolytics. Now, events in hemostasis. First of all, is a vascular spasm. What is vascular spasm? Basically, it is a constriction of a blood vessel. The blood vessel where injury occurs, it becomes constrict. It becomes, its lumen become very small, narrow. This is done to prevent the excessive loss of blood or excessive flow of blood from that damaged vessel so that no blood loss occurs. So vascular spasm occurs. This is done by three mechanisms. One for the vascular spasm is a neurogenic spasm that involves nervous system. Then myogenic spasm that involves muscle constriction and some tissue factors or protein factor that are released from the platelets that causes constriction of damaged vessel. That is vascular spasm. Number second is formation of a platelet plug. Platelet plug formation is a primary hemostasis. Main step, characteristic step of primary hemostasis. What is the third one? Third one is the formation of fibrin plug, blood clot, that is clot formation, and that is the secondary hemostasis. Re-establishment of endothelium means the repair of the damaged vessel and fibrinolysis of the clot that is formed. vasoconstriction. I have discussed how vasoconstriction occurs. These are the some examples through which vascular injury occurs. Platelet plug, white bodies are microthrombi contact with some endothelial collagen. Basically, what happens, platelets are circulating in the damaged vessel. When damaged vessel is constricted, so blood flow restricted to that site, to injury site. So this causes the platelet to come in contact or come in contact with the collagen that are exposed on the damaged vessel endothelium. These platelet binds to collagen fibers that are exposed by the damaged endothelium. When platelet bind with collagen, it also binds with the factor that is von Willebrand factor that is also exposed on the damaged vessel. When platelet is in contact with the subendothelial collagen, what happens to the platelet? It becomes swell, it becomes enlarges, it increases its surface area, irregular with pseudopods. Many pseudopods are extracted from that surface of the platelet. Platelet also releases ADP, adenodiphosphate, adenosine diphosphate, thromboxane A2, phospholipids, HMWK factor. What is the function of thromboxane A2? Basically, thromboxane A2, I have discussed in the previous slide that some factors that causes vascular spasm. Thromboxane A2 is one of them. It causes, when released by the platelets, it causes constriction of the blood vessel, sticky and aggregate. So platelet becomes sticky and aggregate. Also, platelet releases platelet activating factor PAF with release of ATP. Platelet also releases platelet activating factor with ADP. So what is the function of platelet activating factor? Basically, this activates other platelets to form and to become contact with the platelet that is already bind to the subendothelial collagen. So that's why the platelet that is bind to the subendothelial collagen becomes sticky, and therefore the aggregation of the platelet occurs. So fibrin clot, how fibrin clot forms? Basically, if there is a severe trauma, major injury, vascular injury, it takes 15 to 20 seconds to form a platelet. Then minor trauma, 1 to 2 minutes. Then retraction, 20 to 60 minutes. Okay. Steps involving coagulation. The ultimate result of the coagulation pathway is the formation of a prothrombin activator. Prothrombin activators also activates prothrombin to thrombin. That thrombin now cleaves fibrinogen to fibrin fibers. Then fibrin fibers becomes attached to each other to form a polymer and eventually form a fibrin thread. That is, we call a clot. What are the pathways for the coagulation? There are two. Number one is the intrinsic pathway. Second is the extrinsic pathway. Intrinsic pathway is slow while extrinsic is fast. We would later know why intrinsic is slow, why extrinsic is fast. Okay, now third pathway is common pathway. These both intrinsic and extrinsic ultimately lead to the common pathway, that is formation of factor 10, activation of factor 10. That forms prothrombin activator, phospholipids, and calcium in the presence of phospholipid and calcium, hemostasis, extrinsic pathway. I have a great picture in Cummings like this one. This is the picture and damage the very flowchart representation of intrinsic and extrinsic pathway, and you would know the differences between these. First of all, let's come to the intrinsic pathway. Intrinsic pathway is basically activated by blood trauma or contact with collagen. Basically, when there is a defect in the blood or vascular injury or blood trauma occurs, intrinsic pathway activates. What intrinsic pathway causes? It activates factor 12 to activate factor 12. It also activates platelet phospholipids. It also releases platelet phospholipids and activates factor 12 to activate factor 12. Then factor 12 activates factor 9 in presence of HMW kininogen and prekallikrein. So factor 11 activates factor 9 in the presence of calcium. Thrombin that is formed here, it also activates factor 8 to activate it factor 8. Factor 9 along with factor activated factor 8 and calcium. Plus platelet phospholipids. Activates factor 10 to activated factor 10. What are the proteins involving the activation of factor 10? These are the factor 9, factor 8, calcium 2 plus, and platelet phospholipids. This activates factor 10. Then activated factor 10 forms prothrombin activator in the presence of platelet phospholipids. Factor 5 that is activated by thrombin and calcium 2 plus. Basically, prothrombin is a complex of factor 10, platelet phospholipids, and factor 5. Then prothrombin activator causes the activation of prothrombin to thrombin. Thrombin, we know that it would cleave fibrinogen to fibrin and ultimately lead to the clot formation. It is also accelerated by calcium. The role of calcium in these pathway is just speeding up the process. It acts as a just like enzyme that accelerates the process of for activation of clotting factors. Okay, let's come to the extrinsic pathway. Extrinsic pathway, unlike intrinsic pathway, is activated by tissue trauma. When there is a tissue trauma, it releases tissue factor. Tissue factor basically is a complex of lipoproteins, glycolipids, and damaged membrane, phospholipids. These are the complex of the tissue factor that we call tissue factor. Tissue factor activate factor 7 to activated factor 7. Then activated factor 7 activates factor 10 in the presence of calcium and tissue factor. Then again, activated factor 10 forms prothrombin activator by the complex formation through tissue factor, calcium 2 plus, and factor 5. It forms prothrombin activator. Then prothrombin activator activates prothrombin to thrombin, and then again common pathway occurs. Here also the calcium plays a role in accelerating the process of activation. So why the intrinsic is slow and why the extrinsic is fast? Because here you can see that many proteins are involving in the intrinsic, while there is only factor 7, and again then the common pathway starts. And there is a one protein, there are many proteins. So activation of these too many proteins took time. That's why the intrinsic is slow. Okay. Hemostasis, production of clotting factors, where the clotting factors are formed, fibrinogen is in liver. 2, 7, 9, and 10, we know that these are the vitamin K dependent. They are formed in the liver. Factor 8, 5, and factor 12 are endothelium, formed in endothelium. Factor 13 are the platelets. Factor 13 is produced by platelet because factor 13 is a fibrin stabilizing factor. That after the formation of the clot, it stabilizes the fibrin threads, ensuring that the clot is fully retracted. Okay. Hemostasis, thrombin. Thrombin is basically intensely proteolytic enzyme, activates factor 5, 8, and 13, releases phospholipid from endothelium and platelet, activates protein C. We would know the function of protein C in coming slides. Okay, this is how the aggregation occurs. This is a platelet rock formation. Then there is a formation of clot. Okay, hemostasis. Fibrinolysin or plasmin. Plasminogen activator. Let's come to this. Basically, after the formation of a clot, it needs to be removed so that the normal circulation occurs. So there are some proteins that are formed in liver. These are called plasminogen. Plasminogen is an inactive form. When activated, it forms plasmin by the plasminogen activator. Plasmin basically is a proteolytic enzyme that lies the fibrin threads and dissolve the clot. Okay, let's come to this next. Why does not blood clot normally? Why the blood clot does not occur normally? So here are some reasons. Endothelium. First one is endothelium. Because endothelium is smooth for the activation of a clotting factor, activation of hemostasis, the endothelium must be rough. And how it become rough? By the exposure of collagen fibers and von Willebrand factors. Glycocalyx is also smooth coat around the endothelium. Thrombomodulin that bind thrombin and inactivates it. Prostacyclins basically inactivates platelet aggregation. Basically inhibits platelet aggregation. Heparin sulfate, tissue plasminogen activator. And the tissue plasminogen activator, we know that plasmin cleaves dissolve the clot and ADP. Fibrin and antithrombin. Antithrombin 3 is also a protein that inhibits thrombin function. Heparin. And here are some other, just like protein C, it removes factor 5 and factor 8. So inhibiting the intrinsic pathway and extrinsic pathway. And there are other examples. Heparin also in the heparin in with complex of heparin with antithrombin 3 removes thrombin from the circulation. Okay, test for blood coagulation. First one is bleeding time. Bleeding time is normal length of bleeding time is 1 to 6 minutes. Prolonged in thrombocytopenia, thrombosthenia, von Willebrand disease. Bleeding time is basically when a cut is incision is made on the skin and blood starts to bleeding starts there from the incision. From a time of incision made to time where the bleeding stops, we measure that time, and this is called bleeding time. That is normal is 1 to 6 minutes. It is prolonged in thrombocytopenia, that is the decrease in platelet number, thrombosthenia, and von Willebrand disease. Clotting time is basically the time required to form a clot. Normal is 6 to 10 minutes in glass, whilst 20 to 60 minutes in siliconized tubes. These are the basically procedure to measure the clotting time. Measure intrinsic and a common pathway. PT. So test for blood coagulation. It is divided into prothrombin time and APTT plus bleeding time. So first one is prothrombin time. We will discuss it now. So prothrombin time is normal is 12 seconds. It affects extrinsic and common pathway. Basically, when there is a absence of factor 7, that is a factor of an extrinsic pathway or common pathway, prothrombin time increases. Prolonged in oral anticoagulant drug, liver disease, vitamin K deficiency, deficiency of factor 7, 10, 5, and 2, as I have discussed, DIC, disseminated intravascular coagulation. Next, partial thromboblastin time. It is basically measure for the intrinsic and common pathway. It is prolonged in DIC, liver disease, massive transfusion, heparin, circulating anticoagulant, deficiency of clotting factor other than 7. Means that deficiency of clotting factor involving the intrinsic pathway, hemophilia. Thrombin time. Normal platelet count are 150K to 450K. I have also discussed abnormal hemostasis. Natural anticoagulants. Okay, natural anticoagulants involve antithrombin 3 protein CNS. Antithrombin 3 is an inhibitor of thrombin. Its action being potentiated by heparin. It antithrombin 3 with heparin is most effective in removing thrombin. Congenital antithrombin 3 deficiency is inherited as an autosomal disease. These are the disease protein CNS. These are the synthesized in the liver and are dependent on vitamin K. Protein C degrades of factor 5 and factor 8 and promotes fibrinolysis by inactivating plasminogen activator inhibitor. Warfarin is also anticoagulant. Okay. So that's all for now. If you like this video, comment it, share, and subscribe my channel. We will see you in next video.